Welcome to Module 4 of the Partner Practice Enablement Bootcamp for Windows Azure. In this module, we will look at Windows Active Directory and Windows Azure integration. This module will focus primarily on integrating existing on-premise Active Directory with Windows Azure Active Directory. We'll also explore the differences between the supported scenarios and the single sign-on experience that users will encounter in each scenario. We will also look at use cases for running Windows Server Active Directory on a virtual machine in Windows Azure and provide some best practices for this scenario. Our instructor today will be Rick Rainey. Rick is the co-founder of Opsgility, an organization focused on Windows Azure training. Rick is also a Microsoft veteran. He has a wide range of experience across Windows Azure that we are pleased to bring to you through this training. Without any further delay, please welcome our trainer, Rick.
Thank you very much for that introduction. In this module, we're going to be covering Windows Azure Active Directory integration. Today, we're going to look primarily at directory integration capabilities of Windows Azure AD. In particular, I'm going to cover scenarios whereby integration with an on-premise AD are supported. And while this will make up the majority of the content for this module, I'm also going to spend some time talking about scenarios for running Windows Server AD in Windows Azure Virtual Machines, as well as some deployment considerations for doing so. So let's start by talking about how you can integrate an on-premise Active Directory with your Windows Azure Active Directory tenant in Azure. This is a powerful feature of Windows Azure AD that greatly simplifies identity and access management of cloud-based applications for your on-premise users. There are four primary integration scenarios, and I'm going to talk about the first three in this module. The first scenario is called directory sync. And with directory sync, users and groups and contacts are synchronized from the on-premise directory to Windows Azure AD. A key point to note in this case is that when user objects are synchronized to Windows Azure AD, their on-premise password is not part of the data that's synchronized. So what this means is that users will have a different password when authenticating to Windows Azure AD than when they authenticate to the on-premise directory. If you have Server 2012 R2 deployed, then this scenario will also synchronize devices. The next scenario is called directory sync with password sync. And this is simply an extension of directory sync that also synchronizes a hash of the user's password to Windows Azure AD. So this enables users to sign in to cloud applications using their same on-premise password. It's important to note that this is not single sign-on. Even though a user may already be authenticated on-premise through, say, the on-premise AD in Kerberos, the user will still be challenged for his or her credentials when accessing cloud applications through Azure AD. The credentials will be the same, but they will have to re-enter them. Some people call this similar sign-on because at least the same password is used, even though the user is challenged to enter it. Now, for the password sync extension, you should know that the user's passwords are hashed. And it's the hash of the user's password that is stored in Windows Azure AD and not the password itself. Scenario three is called directory sync with single sign-on. This is also known as federated identity because of a federation trust that actually exists between the on-premise AD and your Windows Azure AD tenant. With this solution, users will not be challenged for their username and password if they have already been authenticated on-premise. So in this scenario, the authentication is actually occurring in the on-premise directory. And this is different from the previous two where the authentication is actually occurring in Windows Azure AD. Now to support the trust relationship that you see between the on-premise directory and the Windows Azure Active Directory, a security token service, or STS, must be deployed next to the on-premise directory to handle the WS Federation protocol. In a Microsoft environment, this STS will likely be Active Directory Federation Services, also known as ADFS, but it could also be a supported third-party STS, such as Shibboleth. This table illustrates the differences between the last two scenarios, which are, again, directory sync with password sync and single sign-on. And to reiterate, with single sign-on, your users will not have to re-enter their passwords when accessing cloud applications through Windows Azure AD. And that's just a benefit of the fact that the authentication is actually occurring in the on-premise directory. The client access filtering support in single sign-on is a feature that allows you to make decisions at the ADFS server to allow or deny an authentication request based on the location of the client. So those are some of the important distinctions between the two scenarios, the last two scenarios that we talked about. So now that you understand the supported scenarios for integrating your on-premise directory with Windows Azure AD, let's take a look at what's needed to actually achieve directory synchronization. The first thing that you're going to want to do is set up a server in your domain to be the dir/sync server. It's technically not necessary, but it is recommended so you're not installing the directory sync tool on your AD server. This tool also requires .NET Framework 3.5. So, for example, if you're using Server 2012 as your image, you will need to add this feature in the Windows features. Now, directory sync can be enabled from the Windows Azure Management Portal. And to do that, simply from the portal, select your Active Directory, go to the Directory Integration tab at the top, and you'll see in the page there's a directory sync setting, and you can set that to activated. Once you set that to activated, there's a link down in step 3 to download the directory sync tool, and you'll want to save that to your directory sync server that is joined to the domain. You can also set this up from your Office 365 portal. And to do that, you just simply log into the portal, go to the Users and Groups section, and at the top, look for the Active Directory Synchronization links. There'll be an option there to activate or deactivate. In this screenshot, I actually have it already activated. So there's a Manage link there as well. But when you do that, it'll transition to a screen here, very similar to what you see in the Windows Azure Management Portal. And that is an option to then download the Directory Sync tool, which is in step 4. So once you've got the tool downloaded, the installation is really just a matter of clicking through a few wizards to set things up. Once the directory tool is installed, which by the way, it does take a few minutes for this to install. It took mine about 10 minutes. But anyway, once it is installed, the configuration wizard will start. And the first screen of the wizard is just telling you that you're going to need your administrator credentials for both your on-premise AD as well as your Azure AD tenant that you're going to sync your directory objects to. Next, you're going to enter the administrator credentials for your Azure AD tenant. And if you recall from the last module, this is going to be a user in the directory that is a global administrator of the directory. Next, you're going to enter the credentials for your on-premise AD administrator. And this screen here is just asking if you want to enable the hybrid deployment feature. And what this will do is make it so that changes in the Azure AD can be synchronized back to the on-premise AD. If you only want synchronization of objects to go one way to your Azure AD, for example, then just leave this unchecked. The password sync option is the extension to directory sync that I mentioned previously. This is the option that will result in a hash of user passwords being synced. Next, the tool will set up configuration based on your responses, and this just takes a few seconds. And then once the configuration is complete, you can tell the tool to do an initial directory sync. And that's it. You've now got directory sync with password sync enabled. Let me give you a few details about the tool. The directory sync configuration is one that is already automated to do most of what you'll need. It runs as a Windows service under the service name Windows Azure Active Directory Sync Service. And one nice feature to call out too is if your dir/sync server for some reason were to go offline, an email notification is actually sent indicating that dir/sync is not connecting to the directory for synchronization. So what this means is you can pretty much just let this thing go and forget about it unless you get an email indicating that there's a problem. Now, directory sync runs on 3-hour intervals automatically, and there's nothing you need to do to enable this. It's just on after you install the tool. The password sync extension runs on 2-minute intervals automatically, and this interval occurs if you checked the checkbox in the configuration wizard for password sync. And remember, password sync is just an extension to directory sync. So if you enable it, you're going to see password sync happening every 2 minutes, plus you're going to see directory sync every 3 hours. And finally, you can also run directory sync on demand. And so this is useful in those situations where a new user has been added to, or maybe a user is removed from the on-premise directory. If it is a situation that requires the change to be immediate, then you can invoke the directory sync using PowerShell. As far as monitoring directory sync, the Windows application event log is where you will find activity logs for the directory synchronization tool. However, if you are one of those that prefers a visual experience for directory synchronization, you can also run the Synchronization Service Manager. Heads up, if you do choose this option, you may get an error saying that the user is not a member of the required security group for the application. And if so, then what you need to do is just create a security group named MIIS Admins and add the logged in user to it. There's actually a KB article that explains, you know, why this happens and the workaround in more details. So be sure to check this out if you run into this. Okay, I'm going to show you a demo in just a second on directory synchronization, but before I do, I thought it might be useful to illustrate the configuration that I've set up for the demo. So I have two virtual machines running in Windows Azure to simulate what would be an on-premise environment. I've configured a virtual network and added two virtual machines to it, one for the domain controller, which is called PPEDC, and another VM for running the directory sync tool, which is called PPEDirSync. The Azure AD tenant is the same tenant that I was showing in the previous module, which is ppe2014.onmicrosoft.com. And the PPEDirSync server is just simply going to reach into the directory on the PPEDC server as scheduled and synchronize user objects and groups to my Azure AD tenant. So let's take a first-hand look now at directory sync with password sync. In this demonstration, I'm going to show directory sync with password sync. And how I'll start this off, I'll run you through some of the configuration and logging that's on the DirSync server. And then I'm going to show you a couple of scenarios. We'll look at a scenario where we change the user password for a user in the on-premise AD server and see how that changes synchronized to Windows Azure AD. And then we'll also look at a scenario where we delete a user from the on-premise AD and then use PowerShell to do a forced directory sync of the objects so that that deleted user is reflected in the Windows Azure AD tenant immediately. So to get started, let's go over to the DirSync server. I have a RDP session open to my DirSync server, and DirSync's been running on this for a little while, so I've already got some logging in place. I thought I'd start by showing you some of the logging that you can see from the event log for the DirSync tool. So I'm going to go into the event viewer and go to the application event log. And the directory synchronization logs are going to be from the source directory synchronization. So you're looking for these logs. You can see there's quite a few in here already. Remember that there's a couple of intervals, running intervals going on here. There's the 3 hour directory synchronization interval, which synchronizes adding and removing objects from the local directory to Windows Azure AD, as well as password synchronization, which is occurring every couple of minutes. So you'll see, you know, both of those in here. Let me scroll down a little bit and see if I can find, I did some password changes here earlier, so let me find one of those. Those are going to be, I think this one right here is one. This is a password change, so you can see that in the message there. And it's for user Jane Doe. So this is a user in the directory. I went and changed her password, and that change was ultimately synced up to Windows Azure AD. And this was one of those 2 minute intervals. And you'll see other things in here as well. Some of these logs are not particularly useful, but you can kind of get a feel for when things are running. When you see this export cycle completed, you know, like the 114 event, those are typically running on the 3 hour interval. You see one up here that's about 30 minutes later, but that was because I did a forced synchronization. But typically you'll see these running on the 3 hour interval. So another thing that you can use to view synchronization on the DirSync server is the Synchronization Service Manager. So if you recall earlier in the presentation, I mentioned that this gives you a little bit more of a UI friendly experience. And so many of the same logs that I just showed you in the event log, you can see here as well. But you'll also notice that there's actually some links to the individual changes. So for example, here we saw a change at 6:54 and it had one add and an update. So for example, if I click on the ads link, I can drill into this and see the details of this. Here I was actually adding a user, Carrie, to the directory, the local directory. And so that got synced up to Windows Azure AD. And I'll show you the Azure AD portal here in just a minute. We'll take a look at the users and their presence in the directory in the cloud. The next thing I wanted to show you with this tool, you know, besides being an easy way to see synchronization events occurring real time, it also gives you a way to do some configuration and filtering of how synchronization works. So for example, if you want to go in and do, for example, domain-based filtering, let's say you have multiple domains in your environment, I can go into the Active Directory connector and then go to Configure Directory Partitions. And if I had multiple domains, I could check the ones that I wanted to be synchronized to Windows Azure AD and uncheck the ones that I didn't want. Obviously, I only have the one. That doesn't really do much for me. The next thing, I can do user attribute-based filtering. So I can go into the Active Directory connector, configure a connector filter, and there's a user object type that I can click on. And these are the actual filters. Let me expand this out a little bit more. These are the attributes that we're filtering on for users. So I could, for example, add a new attribute if I wanted to make that part of the filter. I can edit one of these existing ones. Just click on the edit box or the edit link. If I want to remove one of these, I can delete them. So it gives me some control over applying filter conditions for directory sync. So now that you've seen a little bit about the DirSync server, you know, where the logging is occurring and how you can apply filters, let me show you now the Azure Management Portal, and we can see those users that are synced up in the Windows Azure AD tenant there. So here's my management portal, and I'm going to drill into the directory and go to users. And you'll notice these are the same users basically from the last module with a couple of changes. You'll notice there's a Jane Doe user in the directory now, and you'll notice that Jane Doe is sourced from the local Active Directory. So this just is indicating that this user came from on-premise versus, say, user John Doe, who was sourced from the Windows Azure Active Directory. In other words, you saw me enter that user directly into the portal right here. Now, Carrie is also sourced from the local directory as well. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to log into the Application Access Panel as Jane. And then we're going to go over to the domain controller, and we're going to change her password on-premise. And we'll see how her ability to access the application access panel is affected as a result of that on-premise change. So to do that, I'm going to open a new browser window, and I'll go to the application access panel. And I'm going to log in as Jane. And here you can see that Jane has, first of all, I logged in. So that's what's important is I'm authenticated to the application access panel. And Jane has access to certain applications, the Office 365 app, as well as Dropbox. So I'm not going to go into any of these. The important thing is just to see that Jane is authenticated and logged into the access panel. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over to the domain controller, and I'm going to change Jane's password. So before I do that, let me just go ahead and log out, and then we'll come back and log in just a minute. So I have another RDP session over to my domain controller, and I'm going to go in and modify Jane's password. And I'm going to uncheck this box because I don't want Jane to have to go log in to change the password. I just want to force the change on her account right away. So I'm going to uncheck that, click OK. And remember, this change is one of those changes that's on the 2-minute cycle. So let me go back over to the DirSync server. And what we're looking for here is that password sync to occur sometime in the net within 2 minutes. We might be 30 seconds away from the next run. We might be a minute and 59 seconds away. So while we're waiting for that to run, so let's make note of the time there, 7 o'clock. While we're waiting for that to synchronize, let me show you where this synchronization tool is right here that we're looking at, because it's not something that when you install the DirSync tool is placed on your desktop. So where you find this is if you go into Program Files and go to Windows Azure Active Directory Sync, and then go into this Sync Bus directory, Synchronization Service, and then UI Shell, you'll see this guy right here, MIIS Client. So in this path right here, and this was the path that I had called out in the presentation, this is where the Synchronization Service Manager is. So if you want to use this tool, go get it. And what I did here is just pinned it to my taskbar, so it's always available. But that's where you'll find that tool. All right, so let's see if we've got our password synchronization yet. Okay, so here we go. So 724 was I have a log here. And sure enough, there it is. So there's a password change result for Jane Doe. And so now I'm going to go back to the application access panel for Jane and sign in. And I will try first with the old password. And you'll notice that I'm not able to authenticate. So I will now try again with the new password. And there we are. So I'm able to authenticate, and Jane's applications are present just like they were before. Just now we're using a different password. All right, so I'm going to sign out of Jane's application access panel. In this next scenario, what I'm going to do is show we're actually going to delete a user from the on-premise Active Directory and see how we can use PowerShell to force that update to Windows Azure AD, the Windows Azure AD tenant. So for this one, I'm going to log back into the application access panel as a different user. This time, I'll log in as Carrie. And remember, Carrie was also a user that was sourced from the local directory. And like Jane, she has access to some applications, but not many, just the Office 365 SharePoint app. So the main thing here is just to point out that, you know, Carrie is able to authenticate and log in to the application access panel. So what I'm going to do now is switch over to the domain controller, and we're going to delete Carrie from the directory. So to do that, go back to the domain controller, and there is user Carrie. So I'm going to remove her. But before I do this, let me just point out that this is one of those changes to the directory that would fall into the 3-hour directory sync interval. So anytime you add a user or delete a user, for example, those are changes that would land on that 3-hour interval versus password sync, which happens every 2 minutes. So I'm going to go ahead and delete Carrie, and she's now out of the directory. Now what I want to do is, let's say, for example, this is a situation where I want that change to be immediate. So in other words, I don't want her to be able to log into the application access panel and access any of the cloud-based applications. And in order to do that, I need to go over to the directory sync server now. And you'll notice that the last event was at 7:24. Actually, let me refresh this. 7:30. Let's make sure we didn't accidentally pick up the change. No, we didn't. Okay. So what I want to do, I want to force this update of carrier being removed from the local directory to the Azure AD tenant. To do that, I'm going to use PowerShell. Let me show you where we need to go to do this. We're going to go to Program Files, Windows Azure Active Directory Sync, and there is a directory sync configuration shell that we need to run. And this opens up Windows PowerShell. And the command that I want to run is start-online-coexistence-sync. And when I run that, I will see in the event log here in just a second. Let me refresh. You should see, there we go. So we have these events, some warnings from the FEM service. But what we're looking for is a update, directory synchronization success. So now let's go back to Synchronization Service Manager, and you'll notice the same update there as well. So here we have, there's actually a link, so we have the one delete as well as an update. I think the update and the delete are the same, but let's look in the delete. And if I drill into that, you'll see that Carrie, the user, this was the user that was deleted from the directory. So now I'm going to go back to the application access panel for Carrie. Let me sign out and let's sign back in, or try to sign back in. And you'll notice that she's not recognized any longer in the directory. And just to prove that, let's go back here and let's refresh the Windows Azure Management Portal, and you should see that Carrie will no longer be present in the directory. And indeed, she's not. So that's how you would do a forced update of a deletion or an addition to the on-premise directory. And just to, for the sake of being complete, let's also go check out the Office 365 portal. So go to portal, Microsoft. Online.com. Log in as the administrator there. And we'll go to users and groups. And sure enough, Carrie is no longer in the directory here as well. So in this demo, we saw how to look at some of the logs for directory sync. And we looked at a couple of scenarios, one of changing a user's password on the local AD, as well as another scenario of deleting a user from the local AD. And we also saw how to force a directory sync update using PowerShell. So I'm going to transition a bit in this last section and talk about the infrastructure services aspect of running Windows Server Active Directory in a Windows Azure virtual machine. So why would you run Server AD on a virtual machine in Azure? There can be many reasons for doing this, and I just want to call out some of the more common ones to get you thinking about it. One of the first reasons is you may be doing this simply to support requirements for existing application workloads that you want to move to Azure. So, for example, if you're looking to take an existing SharePoint farm and run this in the cloud on virtual machines, then this is a good candidate for running Server AD in a VM as well, to support things like Windows Integrated Authentication, which is something that Windows Azure AD does not provide. You may say, well, I'll just have SharePoint call back down into my on-premise AD. And the problem with this is simply the level of chattiness via directory queries that occurs between SharePoint and Server AD. If your SharePoint farm in the cloud has to constantly call back into an on-premise AD through, say, a site-to-site connection, the latency alone will seriously hinder the performance of that application. Another case may be if you're running SQL Server with always-on availability groups in virtual machines in Azure. In this case, you're going to need a Server AD simply because the failover clustering in this environment requires the presence of an Active Directory domain. Another might be around, say, a DR story, where, say, an organization may just set up a limited set of virtual machines with a Server AD to facilitate branch offices in the event of an outage. And an increasingly popular workload that's being moved to Windows Azure is dev test. So for example, in this case, Say you need to do testing of an application that requires server AD, then standing up a dev test environment in the cloud that includes a server AD instance is really powerful and eliminates the need to run tests using your production domain controller. There can be several other scenarios. These are just some to get you thinking. The point is that sometimes it's just absolutely necessary, and the presence of Windows Azure AD should not prevent you from using server AD when you need to. Many of the same best practices that you would take into account for running Windows Server AD in a virtualized environment on premises apply when running in a virtual machine in Azure. For example, you should not sysprep the domain controller. If your scenario is one where you want to essentially lift and shift an existing physical machine running Server AD to Azure, then you will need to P2V that machine and then move the domain controller's VHD to Azure and then create the new virtual machine from that VHD. Or you could also start by creating a new virtual machine and running Windows Server AD in Azure and then replicate the directory on premise to that virtual machine instance in Azure. And when you're creating your virtual machine instance that you're going to run Server AD on, you'll want to also create a data disk with caching turned off. And you're going to want to store your Active Directory database and log files and such in a way that they're targeting that data disk. You do not want to use the temporary disk or drive D that is present on the virtual machine instance. As far as IP addressing goes, just to reiterate some of the points from the networking module earlier in the course, Windows Azure virtual machines require the IP address be assigned from the DHCP service. So this is one of the few exceptions to the otherwise best practices you would follow for Server AD. Even though this is a dynamic lease, it is an infinite lease. So as long as the virtual machine is deployed, that IP address that's assigned will stick with the virtual machine. Lastly, do not try to assign a static IP to your virtual machine. If you do, you're going to lose communication to it, period. You won't be able to RDP into it. It's essentially a lost machine. Now, there are some theories about how to recover from this, whereby you could delete the logical virtual machine but retain the OS and data disk and then recreate the VM from those disks. However, there's also some theories that this could cause the AD virtual machine to behave unpredictably when you do that. So I'm just going to say don't do this, and if you do, proceed with caution if you do try to restore it, and good luck. The last consideration that I want to mention is regarding DNS. And so when creating your Server AD instance to run in Azure, you will need to deploy DNS on the domain controller because the Azure DNS that's there by default just doesn't support the DNS requirements for AD. This means that when you configure your VNet that your Server AD instance will run in, be sure to specify the DNS IP to target your Server AD VM, as I've shown here on the slide. So I want to come back to the single sign-on scenario that we talked about earlier in the presentation, and in particular, this idea of running ADFS on virtual machines in Azure. If you're planning to implement a pure single sign-on solution in Azure, which as you know now requires the presence of ADFS, then you'll want to take a close look at the guidelines for doing so. Certainly, running ADFS on VMs in Azure is a supported deployment, but it does come with some compromises that you'll have to take into consideration as you go forward. In particular, the ADFS deployment best practices call for requirements in the infrastructure, such as load balancing the ADFS proxy servers and STS endpoints that ADFS exposes for high availability. So in other words, you're going to need the presence of an internal load balancer, and this is something Azure just does not provide. So you're going to have to deviate some from the best practices for some deployment configurations. This diagram is one of a typical ADFS deployment that's running on-premises, and it adheres to all of the deployment best practices. On the left is the ADFS farm that's running in the corporate network behind the firewall, and it's complete with DNS and load balancing for high availability for intranet access. Now on the right side is the Federation server proxies to handle the extranet access, and it's also load balanced for high availability. Now take that same configuration and move it to Azure. The compromise is simply the load balancer in front of the ADFS servers in the intranet environment. And that, again, that's due to the lack of Azure support for an internal load balancer. Now, technically, you could expose the ADFS servers using their VIP and take advantage of Azure's native load balancer that way. However, doing this directly contradicts other best practices that say never to expose your STS endpoint to the internet. So you've got a choice to make. Do you want to compromise on high availability or security? While neither is ideal, I suppose HA is the lesser of the two evils in my opinion. But until Azure provides an internal load balancer, this will continue to be a challenging deployment scenario. So as we wind this module down, I wanted to spend just a minute talking about the application development side of the house as it pertains to identity and access management. So development teams are realizing the ability to reduce development costs, lower the risk for the organization, and really create some powerful and rich single sign-on experiences for users. Gone are the days when developers create separate identity databases or silos, if you will, to manage user access to line of business applications. You know, these practices in the past have led to situations where developers would be end up essentially becoming administrators of these makeshift identity databases. And let's face it, you know, most developers just aren't security experts and therefore really shouldn't be doing this. So in this still fairly new world of claims-based security and a rich set of protocols and all the various token formats, software developers have learned to externalize the authentication for their applications to services that have the ultimate authority for a user's identity. And that authority can be something like Windows Azure Active Directory, or it could be the STS endpoints of an ADFS server that's running on-premise next to, say, a server AD. Whatever it is, the point is that developers are not managing these ITs, and that's, you know, that is a good thing. So by programming to these protocols and consuming these services, things like federation across enterprise boundaries, really makes it easy for developers to build applications that can be consumed by partners, and doing so in a way that leaves the task of establishing trust between organizations in the hands of IT administrators. And then things like multi-factor authentication and using the Graph API to query Azure AD makes it easier to build more secure applications for organizations. And lastly, the Active Directory authentication library is packed full of some really rich APIs for developers to build robust client applications for users. So these are just some of the ways that application developers are taking advantage of Azure AD today and the many features that it provides. And so I just wanted to add this to the end here because I really think it's helpful when you can see how the other disciplines are depending on things and leveraging things like Azure AD to meet their requirements. So we've reached the conclusion for today's module, and here are some suggested learning exercises to augment the learning experience from the content we presented today. There is one hands-on lab, and this is simply the installation of a new Active Directory forest in Windows Azure. So you're going to be setting up server AD on a virtual machine in a virtual network. You will configure DNS and attach a data disk to it. Everything that we talked about in the presentation, you'll get to do hands-on there. The videos, there's a couple of videos to watch. A very good one from last year's TechNet is running your Active Directory in Windows Azure. So that targets the second topic of today's course. And the second one is a short little cartoon video, but does a really good job just explaining Windows Azure Active Directory, leveraging ADFS for federation scenarios, single sign-on. So, you know, it's only 11 minutes, so it's worth the time. So these are some resources that are hand-selected for this module. So most of them have to do with the Windows Azure Active Directory Sync tool. So I've pulled a few articles that are of particular interest there. The ones that target the second topic for today's module is at the bottom, and that is the guidelines for deploying Windows Server Active Directory on Windows Azure Virtual Machines. So that's some pretty heavy documentation there, and you know, I covered it a little bit in the presentation today, but as you open that up and start to look into it, you'll realize, you know, the level of detail and complexities involved in some of those configurations. So be sure to check that out. And also installing a new Active Directory forest in Windows Azure. So that's just more documentation, basically to augment the hands-on lab that I mentioned in the previous slide. So the last two resources I want to call out are the Active Directory team blog. So be sure to follow that blog for announcements from the Active Directory team themselves. And also I wanted to highlight the Cloud Identity blog. This is Vittorio Bertacci's blog, and it does have a little bit more of a developer spin to it, so just heads up. But the way he presents the material, it's a very good read, even if you're not a developer and want to understand what's happening in this space. So I would follow those two blogs for sure. These are some Windows Azure resources. It's just a list of resources that we recommend you also check out. They're not necessarily Active Directory specific, but you'll find lots of really good content here. If you ever have any questions, be sure to check out Stack Overflow and the Windows Azure forums for community support. So coming up next, our next module is going to be Cloud Services, Websites, and Infrastructure Services. So be sure to tune into that. And that concludes today's module. Thank you very much for your time.